as the universe ever winked at you.
I think when Dan and I were trying to figure out what to do next after Game of Thrones, we had in mind that we wanted to do a science fiction show, but we weren't sure which one.
I knew that this was a big science fiction trilogy that everyone was reading, and it was from a Chinese author, so that was really interesting to me.
Xixin Liu, to his credit, created these books that are terrifying for anyone foolish enough to try to adapt them, and also just made us very hungry for the possibilities.
It was always about doing justice to his ideas, which were one of the primary reasons why we were doing this show, because they're unlike any other ideas any of us had ever read, while still staying true to the thing that was going to be most important to the people watching the show, which was the characters in the show and our, what I hope is our love for the characters in the show.
The opening scene takes place at a struggle session at a university in Beijing in the 1960s.
One of the things that sets the show apart is that one of the main drivers is a thing that really happened. And that's generally not the case in science fiction stories.
We're dealing with a historic event. So it's really how do we accurately recreate China in the 60s and 70s?
That's a huge challenge. First, we didn't shoot it in China. Background actors had to learn phonetically all the chants and got all the chants down.
I think what helped me the most is talking to people that actually went through the Cultural Revolution, because they would not only tell you their story, but also very minute details about how people behave in their era. You want to avoid eye contact, for example.
太明朝时就在了。你这些思想很危险。
There's a theme going throughout the series of people finding family, finding a community that is not their biological family.
Here again, we are reminded that in nature, nothing exists alone.
The Oxford Five are a group of five people who have found community and family with each other.
There's very different energies and all very different people, but when they are all together, it feels like the puzzle is complete.
Okay. What did you call your company?
The Nanotechnology Research Center.
That's probably the most boring name I've ever heard.
Don't be a dick, Jack.
Raj is, in most of those interactions, he's a plus one, which is sort of a cool place to be in when there's an old friend group and you're the fly on the wall. You get to observe these different dynamics, how the histories play out in real time.
Are you two fighting right now?
Oh, fucking boy.
Since we were all supposed to be great friends in the show, it was cool to kind of collaborate on this and get to try different things on set and improvise.
Salut.
What do you do then?
I design self-assembling synthetic polymer nanofibers.
I'm doing a bit of study analyzing the results of particle accelerator experiments around the world.
We created this group that we have nicknamed the Oxford Five that doesn't exist in the books. The main protagonists of the three books in the trilogy typically have fairly little interaction with each other, especially in the roughly present day period of the books. They all exist contemporaneously, but they don't really know each other. It makes it a challenge for a television series.
It's a pretty heavy show, so we needed to get a sense of who they are as people before the real weight of the show is thrown on their shoulders.
Explain to me what's going on.
About a month ago, all the major accelerators started generating results that make no sense.
There's a huge amount of heavy lifting in episode one because it was important to get all the chess pieces onto the board, not just the characters, but you know the themes of the show.
They're not too keen on the notion of science being broken.
I don't really understand the science that's broken, to be honest.
I don't understand it either, but it's not good.
We had the opportunity to work with Benny Wong.
There's a famous line in Adventures in the Screen Trade by William Goldman where they're talking about you can solve it by casting. And Benny's one of those actors who any page of dialogue is better after he's read it.
Just be glad you're not a scientist. Shit time to be a scientist.
Rather than dryly presenting the nuts and bolts of the physics, we show what it's doing to the people who were confronted by it.
Three,
2, 1, action.
We're seeing everything through the point of view of people we care about, and that grounds the show.
What kind of game is this?
I don't know. I played Pong.
When you put on the helmet, you know, it's mirrored on each side, and the last thing you would see before you enter the virtual environment are your own eyes looking back at you. So we kind of came up with this great little moment where you see the eyes, and then the eyes merge, and it opens up into the virtual environment.
Level one.
In keeping with the whole idea of experiencing these things through the point of view of someone you care about. This is literally someone's point of view of their own eyes, and then for the first time in, shooting us into almost like a first-person video game where she's looking at her own hands, and so we experience that the way that Jen is experiencing it.
Augie's countdown is also a thing that is emblematic of the inexplicable problems that are confronting the scientists. They are not people to believe in the supernatural, so whatever is happening to her is scary.
How far has it got? What countdown?
Augie, we meet her in a very dark place and we don't really understand what's going on with her. She's really lost and confused and scared.
From Augie's point of view, there's something private that's happening to you. And as a rational person, she's probably leaning towards, there's something wrong with my brain. There's something wrong with me, with my mind. And so at the end, when she sees the blinking stars, and Saul sees the blinking stars, and everyone in the world sees the blinking stars, it ups the ante on that horror, because it's bad enough if you're losing your mind. It's bad enough if there's something wrong with your brain, but it's arguably a lot worse if there's something that's also being witnessed by everybody else on the globe.
I observe the universe winking.
How can it be happening?
Can't.